We were talking about structuralist narratology, and we made this observation that it has acquired an independent existence, almost. That means something which originated in structuralism or structuralist work on fiction. Gradually, it has an existence which is independent of its origin. So it has become a discipline in itself. Right. So how do you see the beginning of structuralist narratology, Rajibul? Somebody else can answer this? Abid, Ilyas, I see. Cheroz, Hafsa? Hafsa is there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Hafsa.
Yes, in the previous lecture, we saw that New Criticism paid attention to specifically to only poetry, whereas Structuralism also approached fiction. And then there, and this was a very important contribution of Structuralism to fiction. Mm-hmm. And then we came upon to narratology. Where the formal aspects of narratives are given importance and attention. Mm-hmm. And from there we moved to Claude Lévi-Strauss's contribution, his contribution as an anthropologist, because he studied myths, and where Claude Lévi-Strauss saw myths in relation to other objects and held them in binary terms. And then he analyzes there are basic themes in all the myths. And myths often explain the idea of origin, and all myths are variation. They vary a little bit, but they carry the same or similar theme.
Mm-hmm. Some basic themes.
Yes, right. Sir. And he talked about myths as a kind of language. Mm. And gave a term, my theme, which is a basic unit of a myth. Good. And then explained myths consist of units and parts, and my theme is the basic unit. So here again we came back to the relationship between parts and units, which again shares the ground with structuralism.
Yeah. And in looking at that classification, we are looking at the human mind, which does the job of classification. That is something very important.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Right. We also mentioned another very important name, and we said that there is a kind of schism, there is a kind of division in structuralism. One sect, you can say, following Claude Lévi-Strauss, and which is the other more important, more influential part of structuralist narratology? Where does it come from? We mentioned one name. Maybe Ramesh, would you like to say something? Yes. Yes, Ramesh.
Sir, I'm just listening to
you. Mm-hmm. So what have you listened so far?
I'm following.
Good. Good.
Yes, sir. I'm just following the question of the comment of the other classmate, and I just joined in.
Good, 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 good. Okay, so let us talk about Vladimir Propp. And as I said, that the title of his book is, and all of you please mute yourself. The title of his book is Morphology of Folk Tales, right? See the notes which I posted. Morphology of Folk Tales. We said that there is something important about the title itself, that it is talking about morphology. And you know that morphology is a term which comes straight from language, which comes straight from linguistics. Here, morphology is basically the study of words. So here, Propp studied folk tales, and which are these folk tales, Russian folk tales. He also talked about one basic unit of those fake folk tales. And what is the word that he used? Function. Function, right? So his study of functions of those fairy tales is important. But before that, we also made one observation that in entire structuralist theory, sentence provides a kind of structure for a narrative sentence. So rules of syntax are used to talk about rules of narratives. And so in a sentence, you have a subject and you have predicate. So that gives us a basic structure of a tale as well. Now, Prop defines function. Function. How does it define function? And you know that function is a word which can also relate to mytheme, morpheme, phoneme, right? So we are talking about a basic unit, and some other theories will also talk about some basic units, but more of that later. So function is basically an act of character. That means whatever a character does, an act of character defined from the point of view of its significance for the course of the action. So for example, a character does something. Character undertakes a journey, right? And what is its significance for the course? What is its significance for the course of the action? So character does something and it has some significance. This is actually function. And a fairy tale has number of functions. When he studied those fairy tales, 100 fairy tales, he identified, folk tales, he identified 31 functions. It is interesting, the number is interesting. 31 functions, right? In 100 fairy tales. And there is another thing that he discovered. There are 7 spheres of action. 7 spheres of action. That means there are 7 characters which recur in all fairy tales. And also there are 31 functions which you can find in these tales. Now all these 31 functions do not appear in all tales. Some tales may have less. Some tales may have 31, but some tales may have less. So he derived 4 important rules. First of all, 4 important rules from his study. And I have written those 4 important rules in the notes also that I have posted. What are they? Functions of characters serve as stable, constant elements in a tale. There is something which is constant. And what is that? Which is constant, which is stable, which is there. And who performs them is unimportant. So for example, there is a journey, maybe. Now journey is constant. Maybe it is there in most fairy tales. But who performs journey? Whether it is a hero, whether it is a villain, whether it is a heroine, this is not certain. So that means there are functions, and functions are stable. They are there in all fairy tales. Those actions are there in all fairy tales. But who does that? It differs. Then second important rule is that there are limited number of functions. Limited number of functions. That means there are 31 at the most. And the third is, and this is very important, the sequence of function is identical. So for example, if you say that the king was there, king married a queen, they had a son, they had an enemy and the enemy was killed. So usually the sequence is the same in these fairy tales. And the most important point, in terms of structure, all fairy tales are the same in terms of structure. So what are these 4 important points? One important point is that there are functions, actions, performed by characters which are stable, which are there in all fairy tales. But who performed that action is unimportant. Second important thing, limited number of functions. And third important thing is that the sequence is the same. And the fourth important thing is, in terms of structure, all fairy tales are similar. Now, what are those 31 functions? This is important. Probably you'll get a clue to this. Nobody can remember all those 31 functions. And least of all, I can remember. So I am reading those 31 functions. It will take hardly 1 minute, but it will give you some idea, right? It will give you some idea about the kind of fairy tales and his study. One of the members of a family absents himself from home. One of the members of a family absents himself from home. First function. Second, an interdiction is addressed to the hero. He is given some order or something. The interdiction is violated. This order is violated. The villain makes an attempt at reconnaissance. The villain receives information about his victim. The villain attempts to deceive his victim in order to take possession of him or of his belongings. The victim submits to deception and thereby unwittingly helps his enemy. I'll give you a list. I'll post this, right? I'll scan this and post it. So you don't have to write this, right? So those of you who were busy writing, I'm repeating this again from function number one. So don't have to write. One of the members of a family absents himself from home. Number two, an interdiction is addressed to the hero. The interdiction is violated. The villain makes an attempt at reconnaissance. The villain receives information about his victim. The villain attempts to deceive his victim in order to take possession of him or of his belongings. The victim submits to deception and thereby unwittingly helps his enemy. The villain causes harm or injury to a member of a family. One member of a family either lacks something or desires to have something. Misfortune or lack is made known. The hero is approached with a request or a command. He is allowed to go or is dispatched. The seeker agrees to or decides upon counteraction. The hero leaves home. The hero is tested, interrogated, attacked, which prepares the way for his receiving either a magical agent or helper. The hero reacts to the actions of the future donor. The hero acquires the use of a magical agent. The hero is transferred, delivered, or led to the whereabouts of an object of search. The hero and the villain join in direct combat. The hero is branded. The villain is defeated. The initial misfortune or lack is liquidated. The hero returns. The hero is pursued. Rescue of the hero from pursuit. The hero, unrecognized, arrives home or in another country. A false hero presents unfounded claims. Most books talk about these last six functions. A difficult task is proposed to the hero. The task is resolved. The hero is recognized. The false hero or villain is exposed. The false hero is given a new appearance. The villain is punished. The hero is married and ascends the throne. You cannot remember all, but if you see the last few, hero wins, villain is defeated, hero ascends the throne, and hero is married. Say that kind of happy ending, that kind of resolution. And before that resolution, there were some problems. Problems were presented by the villain or maybe others. So that is usually the storyline of most of these fairy tales, right? Now, what are those seven spheres of action? Seven spheres of action, that means seven rules. And I have put those seven rules in the notes that I posted. One is obviously the villain, right? Villain. And of course, the donor, somebody who provides something. The helper, somebody who helps. The princess or any sought after person. Any sought after person. Maybe hero is also after that person and the villain is. The princess and her father. The dispatcher, somebody who dispatches the hero or somebody. The hero and the false hero. So if you see the villain, the donor, the helper, the princess and sort and her father, the dispatcher, the hero, the false hero. These are seven important spheres of action. That is seven important rules. Interesting thing about this is that different roles can be performed by one character. Different roles. So for example, there is the role of the hero. There is also the role of the villain. There is also the role of dispatcher. Now they can be combined in just one person. So one person plays maybe three different roles. Right. On the other hand, there is the opposite line also. So one person performs three roles. What is the other way out? What is possible? One person performs three roles. One role is performed by three persons, three characters. Now here I must give you some example from some of those popular films, because this is one area in structuralist theory which is used a lot to also a study of the structure of films. In most books of films, in most books about films, you'll find discussion of Propp's ideas, you'll find discussion of Todorov's ideas and so on. Because narrative is the most important aspect of any film also, right? So if you see these seven roles, let us think about any typical Hindi film. And even Ramesh has seen many because he's working on something. Now what happens? You can see a film where there are three villains. But I don't think all these three villains, two of these villains are trying to say offer hero something very good and one villain is trying to offer villain something very bad. No, actually all three villains are trying to harm our hero in some way. So that means there is one role which is performed by these three villains. On the other hand, if you see some films, say of Shah Rukh Khan of his early period, he's a hero, but he's also an anti-hero. He's a hero, but he's also a villain. Very sadist kind of villain. So there, say, you can see the role of the villain and the role of the hero is also combined in the same person. Many comedians actually were very unhappy that our heroes in 70s started doing comedy. Otherwise, there used to be a role for a comedian in all films in 1960s. Say from say Mahmood to Johnny Walker to Asrani, but later the role of comedian was also combined with the role of the hero. So Propp is talking about 31 functions which are there in all say fairy tales. Not every fairy tale has those 31 functions, but those 31 functions emerge from his study of those fairy tales. And then of course seven is spheres of action. And what is the basic unit for Propp? Basic units is function. So when we are discussing a tale, when we are talking about a story, we are talking about the structure of that story in terms of various functions. Now comes one very important question. There is that formalist position where one is talking about structure. And let us think about any book or let us think about any film. You see a film, you read a book, you love reading that book, you get some pleasure out of reading, and you also get some pleasure out of watching a film. And you also appreciate, you see, oh, this is beautifully done. oh, beautiful camera work is here, or oh, it's a beautiful sentence, or oh, this character is, say, presented so well. So this entire discussion of something beautiful, it is the aesthetic aspect of any work of art, be it painting, be it film, be it literature. So aesthetic aspect, right? Prop actually is not too concerned with that aesthetic aspect. We'll come back to this point a bit later. Then there is another aspect also. You see a film and you feel sad, you feel happy, you feel disgusted, you feel terrible, you feel very melancholic, or you start laughing. That means these are all various responses evoked that by work. Audience react to a particular work. So that is the response evoked in an audience. This is yet another aspect of a work. There is that aesthetic aspect, and it is not always necessary that a work evokes the same response. I remember a gentleman asking me a question, which is the most terrible movie which is running in cinema houses these days? I couldn't understand the question. I named the movie. Then I said, why are you asking this film? He said that I want to show that movie to my wife. Not a very good thing. But thing is that even if wife liked that film or disliked that film, here we are talking about two different kinds of responses. Maybe I like something, maybe somebody else dislikes something. I found it very, very difficult to sit through Salman Khan's film Ready. It was very difficult, but I saw a person sitting beside me. He was laughing and he was enjoying that film, and he was watching that film third time maybe. So audience response is also something which is an aspect of literature or art. So one is the aesthetic aspect, you appreciate something. One is this aspect where say response is evoked. But prop is a functionalist. Prop is a formalist. Prop is not interested in these questions. Prop is interested only in talking about the structure of a work, not its aesthetic qualities. And then we realize that there is another very interesting insight that comes from prop. And what is that interesting insight? That interesting insight is, he says that the aesthetic quality of a work lies in the realization of its tale. So there is a tale, there is its structure, but when we see that structure formally, we are not talking about the aesthetic quality. But that structure is realized by a writer. Basic structure is there. Say hero, villain, heroine, this and that. But this structure is used by a writer, used by a playwright, used by a filmmaker, and in a way that is realized, made real, that is concretized, that is given some substance using that form. So that means that there are two aspects of a tale. One is the invariable aspect, something which is always there in a tale, those functions which are always there. And there is also the variable aspect. Invariable is something which does not change. Variable is something which changes. So what is the variable aspect? Variable aspect refers to external qualities of characters. And what are those external qualities of characters? Say a character's code, character's age. How old a character is this? A character's personality. How does a character look? A character's peculiar, say, certain peculiar characteristics. How does he behave? How does he talk? His status, his sex. These are all important aspects of a character. So let us see it this way. We are watching different films. We are giving examples from films, and we have seen maybe hundreds of films. And what we see in those films, a particular kind of structure, some of those functions, and prop identified those functions, and prop also identified those seven characters. So maybe we see those characters, maybe we also see those functions. We identify those functions, we identify those characters. A change may come if that character is played by two different actors, visualize two different actors, visualize five different actors who are playing that particular role. There is also something called commutation test. There was an old film of Sridevi. It was Ladla. Initially, another actress was signed for that film. What was the name of that actress actually who jumped from her apartment window and in fact died? I mean, I'm not able to recall that name. Can somebody recall that name?
Okay. Divya Bharti.
Divya Bharti, fine. So Divya Bharti initially played that role, but she was there for only few reels. So if you see that role played by Divya Bharti and later that role played by Sridevi, you see world of difference. What is this? This is the variable aspect. The thing is that that character is there. That is the invariable aspect. That character is there. But how that character is realized, if it is played by Divya Bharti and if it is played by Sridevi or if it is played by somebody else, that is a variable. That is a variable attribute, variable quality. And there lies the aesthetic quality. So aesthetic quality is an aspect of variable aspect of a tale. I hope you follow this discussion. There are some invariables, some invariable aspects. Those rules, they are invariable. Those functions, they are invariable. They don't change. Those functions are there in all fairy tales. Those rules are there in all fairy tales. But who plays that role? It is an aspect of aesthetics. So for example, if a character is small, if a character is big, if a character is very eloquent, if a character stammers, if a character wears Indian dress, if a character wears another dress, these are all aspects of aesthetics. And prop is not interested in the question of aesthetics. Similarly, there are things like how something is received by audience. Prop is not interested in that question either, right? So if we see here that prop is an important name in structuralist narratology, and as I said just now, that all later work uses props categories. So those 31 functions and those 7 spheres of action, those 7 roles, all other theorists who come after prop, they try to use his work and possibly say something by using his work. Let me take just one or two examples. There is another important name. His name is A.J. Grimas. Again, you'll find this in your notes, so you don't have to note down. A.J. Grimas. Now, what Grimas does, and I'm not discussing Grimas in great detail because I have to discuss one very important name, that is Roland Barthes. Grimas reduces props categories of 7 spheres of action. So prop talked about 7 spheres of action. And what does Grimas do? He talks about 3 pairs of binary oppositions in tales. So when he studies narratives, he studies narratives in terms of 3 pairs of binary oppositions. And what are they? Subject, object, sender, receiver, helper, opponent, these are binaries, somebody who helps and somebody who opposes. Somebody is a subject and somebody is an object. Somebody is a sender and somebody is a receiver. So these are categories which are taken from prop, but they are reduced. They are made neater. cleaner, or as he thought, Remus. There was another important name. His name was Todorov. Right? Todorov also used these categories, but I'll discuss Todorov's work tomorrow. And I'll discuss Roland Barthes tomorrow. Meanwhile, I must give you at least 5-6 minutes so that you can say something, you can sum up. And here, as it has been suggested to me, I will ask you to mute yourself. And if you want to say something, just unmute yourself. Yes. So anybody can say something. Even those of you who are not from Aligarh, who are sitting somewhere else, those of you who are not part of the university, because this online lecture can be joined by anyone if somebody wants to join. Basically, we are talking about, say, these classes which are the need of the hour in different universities. Say, students are struggling. So even if there are students from other universities, some of your friends, so they are welcome to join this. Okay, let me hear from you. Alia, are you there? Manalini, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Manalini.
Yes, sir. Actually, I'm not able to attend previous class. I just want to confirm the name that you discussed about the seven sphere.
Vladimir
confusion because I'm not able to.
No, I have posted.
Sorry, sir.
I have posted these notes on the WhatsApp page of your class, right? So you will get that name with proper spelling, right? Manalini, yes.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, Alia, you're saying something?
Yes, sir. Sir, what I realize in this is that somewhere he has a structuralist notion in his mind, and he was more into like talking about the rules and regulations and what are the binding rules and regulations that forms a part of narratology. So what we learn from them, what is the moral, what is the message, and what are the aesthetics ideology, these are not the prop's idea or his not main concern. And in addition to it, I think as far as I realize in this lecture is, as we move ahead, we saw that all the works that he has decided or all the functions that he has decided, they are being cut short, but they are like changing into more broader realm. Then, like, for example, he divided into 31 functions, 7 spheres, then they are reduced to 6. Then the reduction is there, but in addition to it, this reduced idea, these reduced terms, they are themselves more broader in another sense. This is what I realized.
I'm happy that you understood this entire thing very properly, because he is not concerned with aesthetic dimension. He is not concerned with the response, and he is only concerned with the structure, because all those other qualities possibly are not his concern. Absolutely, you got it right. There are, of course, some scholars from outside the university also. Dr. Faiz, he teaches English at Welkin University. Dr. Faiz, would you like to say something? Okay, Faiz, maybe you are not ready. So let us. Sajjad Rashid, are you there? Is your connectivity good?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm there.
Yeah. So maybe just you can add a few things.
Okay, sir, I was thinking about the traditional Hindi movies. We can relate the 31 functions and these spheres given by the Vladimir Prop. Can we relate these? Because those movies, traditional movies, are the reflection of these functions, I would say. Most
maybe,
of the movies.
Yeah, maybe we can talk about it in our next session tomorrow, especially because Todorov's work is even more relevant to those films. Todorov. That's why I thought that I should discuss Todorov. Right, thank you.
Right. And, thank you, sir. I'm following your lectures. Today it was my second lecture. Thank you very much for giving this.
Yeah, good, to good, us. Good. I'm happy. Yeah.
Thank you.
There is a question from somebody. Can you explain invariable and variable that you just explained? Okay, Zainab asked this question. Yes. Zainab Sahib. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, Zainab.
Yes, sir. I can.
Yeah, Zainab. It's a good question. You want to say something first?
Yes, sir. It's like if we see the invariable aspect, then we can say that these are like the base. It is like a basic structure that remain very constant, and it is related to the rules and regulations idea, so they are not going to change anyway. And another aspect of the tail that is like, if we can connect this to an example of the tail in which there are certain types of round characters and flat characters. So invariable aspects are like the flat characters that are not going to change in any way. Mm-hmm. And variable aspects, these are like the round characters that they are going to change in a course of story. So variable aspects, these are like we can place one character and in place of that character, we can put another character. And the way we change the character, this leads to the change in personality, their traits, their behavior. And so it changes the entire idea. So this is what I realize.
Wonderful. Actually, it is a question of realization of that tale, how it is realized, how it is visualized, how it is seen, right? And so invariable, as the term signifies, invariable, something which does not change. And here it relates to structure. Say, okay, this is the structure. These are the functions. These are the units which are there. And variable aspect, when it is realized, when it is visualized, and who is the character, how does the character look like? Maybe there are two different tales, that character looks differently, right? So for example, in one tale that character is black, in another tale that character is white, and in yet another tale that character has curly hair. In one tale that is the character has, say, straight hair. And of course, even straight hair or curly hair, they can also mean lots of things. So it is a question of realization, which is the variable aspect. And of course, from tail to tail, you'll find difference, right?